Okay, welcome from me to everyone and to our guests especially. We do this talk in English. It's a little strange for me to talk to you in English, but with due respect to our friends here and for the video viewers at home, it is easier to do this in one language. I hope you all have a translation device. You can get it right beside the bar if you need one. So we have the possibility to have the talk afterwards in English and in German. You don't need to put the questions in English. So I'm very happy to introduce my both guests, Sarah Harrison and Jacob Appelbaum. Both are journalists, investigative journalists, maybe you know them, maybe not. I will not say too much, but Sarah Harrison is traveled to Hong Kong and basically saved Edward Snowden from becoming snatched by the NSA or CIA or whoever. And Jake Appelbaum has a long history on doing research, investigative journalism on technical issues, sometimes related WikiLeaks and so on. So I just start the talk, and half of the time we have will be possibility to do question answers with you, the audience. And thanks for coming here. Sarah, please, would you give us some summary of what is the state of the global surveillance, global surveillance state or global system of surveillance? What do we know?
Not enough, Glenn.
With the microphone.
Not enough, Glenn. Well, we have under 1% of the Snowden documents published at the moment by The Intercept and the others. So I'm sure there's a lot more. But what has become clear is the concept of a large global surveillance state engineered by the United States, particularly in conjunction with its Five Eyes partners that will spy on their allies and will generally attack activists and journalists more than they will stop terrorists.
Jake, would you like to add?
Yeah, I think that what we see is actually a new way of doing internet monitoring, but that this is not how we think of the internet normally. When you pick up the telephone, you don't think of that as the internet, but electronic communications, essentially all of them together, they are the internet. It's not just the internet protocol. And it's not just the Americans. The Russians also have their SORM system. We see, for example, that the British has Tempora. Each different place, including Germany, has mass surveillance systems. And what Snowden has revealed is effectively some of the inner workings of that and some of the specific instantiations of those ideas. But they don't belong just to my country. They belong to all of our countries. And in Germany, that's especially the case. Although Germany tends to use American-made surveillance, it is also the case that Germany makes surveillance products for export elsewhere. And so this is, I would say, the core thing that we've learned is the new modality of operations and how these things take place.
Yeah, I think one of the most interesting aspects to sort of progress is it's not just the technical side, but we're getting more and more of an understanding of the geopolitics of it. So there's political relationships between corporations and governments, but also the cooperations on surveillance really map in a very real way the geopolitics of the whole world about who's working with who. The GCHQ program, Tempora, that Jake just mentioned, for example, the US basically has full access to it because, well, we're the UK, so we roll over to whatever they say. Germany, of course, has a historical relationship with the United States, so, of course, they have a great partnership on it, too. So there's a number of the history of geopolitics is also displayed in this modern surveillance state as well.
So let's spend a moment on this. How does it work, the co-working of the security services? I understand it's some kind of network and there's some burden sharing going on.
I mean, effectively depending on which Secret Service you're talking about, you have partnerships that are made behind the scenes, maybe even without political leaders knowing about it. For example, the CIA and the NSA and the Bundesnachrichtendienst and the Verfassungsschutz working together effectively. And I say effectively in the sense that they really are teaming up to make effective work, where they're basically one unit in how they work. They use the same surveillance software, they train them, they have different accesses, they help them in different ways. So they really are kind of transnational, you know, in the spirit of internationalism, essentially, but not in the way that we like to think of internationalism. But that's what it is. And it's kind of terrifying, actually. In the case of the British, the United States government actually funds the British GCHQ. And this is a really interesting thing because one of the levers of control of intelligence services traditionally is economic leverage. So you defund someone and then they can't do something. But in this case, the British Parliament hadn't funded the GCHQ to do many things, and the NSA funded them to do those things instead, effectively suggesting that the NSA could tell the GCHQ what to do, removing one of the levers of governance. And so when you see that, there's a sort of hierarchy of funding. Economics rule everything. So the economics of GCHQ and the NSA working together are very important for showing the lever of power. And I mean, I think that that in itself is terrifying, and it tells us quite a lot about who actually runs these things. And it suggests, for example, that the British Parliament, even with their hereditary power system, which is horrifying, that they're not even really in control of that, but rather my country is in control of their intelligence apparatus, which is, I mean, in some ways it's fine by me, because I don't really like the British anyway. But I say that sort of jokingly, but then it's actually horrific if you think about it from a human rights perspective. But I mean, there's a reason we shot the British and created the United States. It still exists today. They have a hereditary power structure, which is completely disgusting. They have a monarchy, which is completely disgusting. And so in some sense, I'm glad that global capitalism has at least crushed part of British society in a really sort of postmodern ironic sense. That's a little off topic from your question, but I just wanted to, I just wanted to share that, because I think it warms the, there's a German phrase for that, Herzerwärmt, right? And it's, oh, the irony runs so deep there, so.
Thank you. You may want to add something, Sarah.
I mean, the other thing that they've been doing on that sort of front, the Americans, they've also, for example, been advising countries on how they can essentially fiddle their own laws and get around it to allow the extent of U.S. surveillance that they want those countries to take place. So even when they say, we'll introduce this program, or, well, we can't, it's against our laws, we found the loophole for you. So they're really not just breaking all of the laws themselves, they're actually helping other countries, their supposed allies, do it, and meanwhile spying on them as well. So... I think the other thing that's interesting that has come out are the cases where it's they've been influencing decisions through it. So by understanding the intelligence, getting intelligence of what's going on within certain, for example, the Copenhagen climate discussions, and then by trying to use that intelligence covertly to influence those discussions taking place. And there's a few examples of that that will come out as well.
Okay, thank you. You want to add more? Okay. So, what is the political consequence of this? If we have this terrific revelations summed up, 2 years of really embarrassing, exciting news, and what does it all sum up to politically?
Do you mean what should they be or what have they been?
Both.
Okay, well, we're in Germany, so let's take Germany as an example. I speak to so many Germans, and they're very annoyed about how little the reaction has been. It is actually one of the best in the world. There is an inquiry here. And if you take your position, the opinion of many people that I've spoken to from Germany about how little it is, then just imagine the fact that you're doing the most. So everywhere else in the world, pretty much, it's even worse. I think actually one of the problem is this geopolitical relationship that comes out that the surveillance is a part of. For example, whether the own committee members actually conducting the inquiry, who are the BND beholden to? Them or the Americans? And these sorts of things have been quite a few sticking points. And I think that in the inquiry process, and I think that actually... we have to work out how to get around those political relationships first if we're actually going to deal with the surveillance topic, because at the moment they're the barricades.
I mean, in some ways, I agree with everything that Sarah says about this. I mean, Germany is leading the way on basically all of this. And in some ways, I think that's really great. I mean, part of the reason that a number of us came here was because we had a great hope that Germany would lead the way on that. And it's been a safe place to work. And I mean, it really is incredible to be able to, for example, just on short notice to have an event where we can talk about these things, or planned long in advance, and we know that there'll be a sustained interest in it, right? Everyone coming here tonight is evidence of at least one of those things. I think actually both, depending on how you heard about it. And I have a lot of hope actually about that. But it's very clear to me that the fact that it involves technology, it gives, let's say, politicians and some of the people that they work with, especially their appointees, a lot of leeway even in Germany. So for example, today, the prosecutor, Range, he made a statement in the BBC, which was quite possibly my favorite statement by a prosecutor ever, definitely in Germany. He says that he had inquired with the NSA about information on spying on Chancellor Merkel, which, by the way, I revealed that in Der Spiegel. This was the story where we showed that they had been spying on Chancellor Merkel's cell phone. And everybody wants the phone number. I got it later. She still hasn't changed it. which means that the original tasking order for surveilling her would still be in effect. It would literally have continued working with no problems whatsoever. He asked the NSA for this evidence, and they didn't provide it. So they are dropping the case as of today. I don't know if you've all heard this, but as of today, they're dropping the inquiry because the alleged criminal organization, organized crime, everybody, that is the NSA, they didn't provide enough evidence about their wrongdoing, so the prosecutor decided that it was impossible to continue the investigation. Now, in some ways, that makes perfect sense, but only if you're fucking high on acid does that make sense. I mean, but that's one way. I mean, it's mind-blowing to me, because it's very clear that she's been spied upon, and it's very clear that created tensions, and that created a political outcome, which was not the outcome that the politicians in a position of power wanted to have. But it's imagining that you have a murder case, and you go to the suspect, and you say, could you give us the murder weapon? And he says, which would be his right, let's say, I'm not going to cooperate with your investigation. And you're like, oh, well, in that case, we're going to just close the case. No problem. And in effect, that's actually what we see happening today, literally today, in Germany. So I don't know what political action people are supposed to take now in response to this. For example, are you guys all supposed to march down to Mr. Range's office and demand that he reopen the case? The problem is, it's not clear to me what actions actually can be taken in this sense. Is he saying we don't have evidence of that? But the fact of the matter is, there's plenty of evidence of mass surveillance. And in fact, there's so much evidence of mass surveillance that it's an undeniable thing. The BND and the Verfassungsschutz have access to the X key score system. That's an established fact. It's established in the inquiry. It's established through the documents. It's established through testimony of analysts. It's established in so many different ways. Even Snowden himself has talked about this. And for this person to drop that case is, in a sense, to show what the actual political effect is, which I think is not what you want as the political effect, but that is the political effect, which is that Merkel and actually basically everyone in German politics in some way has let this be the political outcome. But I'm not sure what to say about that. I'm not sure what to tell you what to do. I mean, throw a brick through a window, that's probably not going to change anything. It might make you feel good, but it's not going to actually stop mass surveillance. And it's not clear that we can get Range to change his mind, because I think that the Chancellery didn't want Range to succeed at this. So obviously they're not going to be supportive of it. So the political outcomes of this, I think, are that you end up with a mass surveillance state. And I don't really like the term surveillance state, but we end up with a mass surveillance society or societies. And that is, in fact, where we are now. And that is, in fact, the political outcome. And unfortunately, that requires individuals to take action, which doesn't solve the problem, because you need industrial scale change. And yeah, I mean, Germans are basically on their own from protecting themselves from mass surveillance, and their state is not protecting them. That's the fact, and that's the same everywhere in the world. But at least in Germany, the state is telling you that. That's really an improvement over other places. I mean, in the United States, Obama says, we don't spy on Americans. Whoops, we spy on Americans, right? And so he lies about it all the time. At least in Germany, they say, well, we just don't have any evidence to prosecute very specific people being spied upon. But they're not disputing that mass surveillance is real, which is, I think, kind of nice.
Yeah, I mean,
it's a step forward.
To put this all in context of how Germany is doing better, my dear Prime Minister has come out saying we have passed the time where law-abiding citizens can feel that they have a right to not be surveilled anymore. So he's actually saying, I mean, he literally just came out 2 weeks ago and said, just because you're law-abiding doesn't mean that we shouldn't have the right to surveil you. So that's where many other countries in the world are. So the fact that there's many Germans and you actually have many politicians saying this isn't right and we should investigate this is like a million zillion miles on from so many other places where we're actually outlawing encryption, we're making surveillance mandatory. It's a completely different reaction.
Actually, in Australia, something really crazy is happening, which is basically the Australian government has decided to reinterpret some of their international trade and commerce laws and export regulations. And they want to effectively make it so that you can't talk about cryptography or about mathematics, certain branches of mathematics. And to do so would be violating export regulations. So you can't like put your online class up about crypto, because if you do, you would be potentially helping ISIS or something like that. That's the theory. But in practice, what it means is that if you work on the things that protect you from mass surveillance, and you're doing it in Australia, you're toying with a 10-year prison sentence per charge or something crazy like that. Now, to Germany's credit, I mean, I think talking about things in terms of nation states is a little bit weird because it's not really to Germany's credit, but to some of the discussion that's taking place in Germany, people are suggesting that you should use encryption. They are actually looking to fund encryption tools. It's the exact opposite of the Australian reaction. It is the opposite of the British reaction. And that is important because it suggests that people here do care about protection. They do care about actually stopping it, but maybe not equally. Because the same people that are funding that are also interested, I think, in some cases, in funding mass surveillance when it benefits them. Obviously, the Chancellery doesn't stand against mass surveillance. She was just mad when she was spied on, which tells you how she feels about everybody as opposed to herself, right? I mean, that's important, right? I want to see no surveillance for anybody, and that's not the same goal. We don't have the same political alignment. And a lot of people, I think, probably would say, well, targeted surveillance is okay, mass surveillance is wrong. And this is a false distinction, and whenever someone presents it to you, you should reject it, I think, because actually, what the British government has just come out and said is that the future of surveillance is going to be bulk CNE, or computer network intrusion, where they break into computers to extract data. So the notion of targeting a specific computer to exfiltrate data is something they want to do at mass scale to pull data out. So they're basically, everything is about mass surveillance, about bulk transfer of information. And you don't really hear a lot of that debate in Germany. You don't hear a lot of people saying, what we should do is break into every computer and siphon all the data out. So there is, I think, a political effect here that comes from a history in Germany, which is a quite scary history in some cases, is that actually the people here remember that. And in the United States and Australia and in the United Kingdom, it's really a forgotten thing. It's the lesson that Americans generally learned about the Second World War was a false lesson that it was only Germans. It wasn't a human phenomenon, right? The GDR was not at all something about humanity. It was just about an instantiation of tyranny in Germany, and that's a German thing, and that's false. And so you see people essentially saying, we could never go wrong. We can never do bad with these things. But today, for example, we saw some NSA documents released, or yesterday, I guess, we saw some NSA documents that were released where the computer hackers working for the Tailored Access Operation, TAO group at NSA, they know that they're involved in kinetic operations. So they break into a computer, they exfiltrate data, and then they know that that data is used to kill people. So they know that they're a part of literally an assassination machine, and they're aware of that. And I feel like somehow that's acceptable in American society, and there's a forgetfulness about what it actually looks like to be doing tyrannical, scary things. And I think in the German debate, you have a little more consciousness about that, and that's very Yeah, that's a huge difference in the political outcome. And I think that it's possible that there can be really, really different political outcomes about certain topics, especially about the drone wars and how surveillance enables the drone wars. And I think because of the European Court of Human Rights, actually there are obligations and treaty obligations that ensure that when that information comes out, there's trans-European ways of dealing with the people that break those rules. So I have a lot more hope for Europe and Germany with regard to these massive human rights violations than I do, say, in the United States, where, yeah, well, it's there's no hope in a lot of ways.
Okay, thanks. As I understand, I think it's very interesting. For me, as a German left, I have a more skeptical point of view on this. I see the starting point, but as you mentioned, one of the basic goals of global mass surveillance is to collect data, to put it into this killing machine, as you said, and at the end you get drone killings, targeted killings on base of suspicion. They are killing terror suspects, and everyone in Germany from the political parties say, okay, we won't support that because it's illegal. Most parties, I think all parties in the German Bundestag are saying exactly this. But on the other hand, we have had more revelations some weeks ago, and we have heard about it last year from former drone operator Brandon Bryant, that we have as base of the drone war is the central intelligence hub for steering the drones is Germany, Ramstein Air Base, and every single bit of information which is controlling the drones, which we get from the drones, which they get from the drones in measure of surveillance, goes through this single point. So there would be no drone killing in the whole world at this time without this airbase. So it's accepted.
They just find somebody else. You're not that important to them.
Yeah, they will do. Yeah, actually, they build a base in South Italy. Yeah, and we will see that it's get diversified. But if you take this, how can you say we have a good base for the debate? I think we need more political pressure, because so far nothing comes of this knowledge about Rammstein.
Okay, to be clear, I don't think Germany is going to save everything. However, you do have a debate that is definitively happening in a different context because of your history, with different, more people saying that mass surveillance shouldn't happen in different demographics than you do in any other country that I have seen. So just to be clear, I'm not, when you say you're I'm not opposing what you're saying of your, yeah. You just, it is different, and you, I mean, the reaction in our country is we're just making it legal, in fact, even making it worse. We're abolishing our Human Rights Act. I kid you not, we're abolishing our Human Rights Act. We're banning encryption, and we're making mass surveillance. You can, if you're a tech company in the country, you have to allow mass surveillance. I mean, that is actually what our country is definitively doing, and the statements our Prime Minister is making at the moment, that that's the direction they're going. You guys have an inquiry, and politicians, I mean, one was going to sit on this stage, sadly she's ill, but politicians that are going to sit here, engage with the public and have this debate. It is a completely different environment, as much as you're not necessarily where you should be.
I think with the drone war, I mean, so I'm very interested in German history of the 20th century. In particular, Ulrike Meinhof is someone I think is like one of the most brilliant writers. I think you're not supposed to say that in public, but before she jumped out the window, and after she jumped out the window, she's a different person. So I'm talking pre-jumping out the window, Ulrike Meinhof. And I think that, interesting person, really great writer. It's a little difficult for me to read her writing in German, but I struggle and I try. And I think we need more people that have the same thoughtful critique that work people to action. I don't think the actions that she ended up taking later in her life are the right actions, personally. But I do think that you need direct action. So yeah, Rammstein is in fact the hub of a bunch of murder. So you should shut it down. Shut off the water, shut off the power. You know, what do they call it? An die Kette? Mm-hmm. And I think that, I mean, that's clear. Like, you don't need, like, a politician to tell you that, right? You need to just organize people. I mean, the anti...
And you actually don't need a politician to do it either, which is the interesting thing. The waterman, the...
Yeah, exactly. You need people who have very specific skill sets. And I think, personally... Oh boy, did that sound inciting. But I mean that in the most nonviolent way possible. Just to be clear, if you shut off the water, you could do it by turning the tap. And I think that obviously it's meant to be self-sustaining, so it's very difficult to actually do that. But, you know, the anti-atomic power movement, the actual greens stretching across all of society working on making the ecology of the planet something more sustainable, I mean, you see incredible political action. It doesn't just come from the parliament. And we obviously need to have, for example, one of the effects of mass surveillance, of this drone killing, we need to actually have political action on that. And I do think a big part of it is the US military base. But the other part of it is actually that the chancellery and other bodies, they know that this is happening. That's just like a fact. I mean, this is not breaking news we're talking about. John Goetz published Geheimniskrieg, like what? Geheimniskrieg like 2 years ago or something like that. So, I mean, this is not... I mean, at this point, it's a normalized reality that this happens. And at some point, if the German government delays long enough, the US will be able to move their drone operation relay centers to another country, probably in Italy or another place. And so maybe Germany will be able to wash their hands of this problem sooner or later. And I think that's actually very problematic, because it means that you'll lose the ability to actually interfere with it. And that's what should happen. Someone should interfere with it. Revealing it is one step to interfering with it, but it actually takes direct action. And I think the direct action that's necessary is, in fact, to, like, stop. Find the people that are doing it, figure out who they are, find their photographs, find their names, ask them nicely to stop. Some of them will probably stop once they realize they don't have anonymity, actually, and some of them will continue. When those people are not on U.S. Army base or Air Force base soil anymore, arrest them. They are committing serious human rights crimes. Find a prosecutor, probably not Range, for example, that's willing to prosecute them, and prosecute them. They're involved in a conspiracy to commit murder against unknown people, and sometimes known people. I mean, but there's very clear steps, but then what does each person in the audience do? It's very unclear what that step is, and that's why people feel very disempowered, not just about mass surveillance, but also about drone strikes. But I think the answer is you have to figure out what the right thing is. And the 68ers, I think, they talk about the long march through the institution, or the, you know, this, some of you are old enough to remember that, right? The ones that are falling asleep mostly. Sorry to say it, but there really are some 68ers falling asleep in the audience, but not you. I see you're awake and frowning. Sorry. But I actually think what's better than the long march through the institution is the short march through the institution, right? Snowden was inside for 10 years. Look what a difference he made. So all of you, if you really think the drone war is a problem, go do a short march through the institution. Don't do the long march. Don't throw your life away with a thing that probably isn't going to work out. Go find exactly the office where there are serious crimes being committed, and go be an intern. Blow the whistle on them. Infiltrate them, right? What does my shirt say? It says, infiltrate with love, or something like that. So, oh, it's on this side, yeah. Sorry, we made these shirts last night for the Burkheim concert. I really think that's the right strategy. You can also go and, like, you know, make like an arm, you know, arm chain around the building or something like that. But if you want to be effective, you have to analyze the structure, find the weak points, and knock the pins right out. That's the thing to do. So if you want to stop surveillance of political parties, find the people that are the most likely to have something incriminating happening. If you wiretap them, which is the wrong thing to do, they're going to have secure communications in the future, right? The chancellery is probably not having trouble with being spied on anymore. They're going to adapt, but they're not going to help you to adapt because they want to use that power against you. But find the weaknesses and then just go for it. And I think it's important to draw the line. I mean, this is where I really disagree with Ulrike Meinhof and Andreas Bader, obviously. I think you should draw the line at violence. I don't think property damage is violence against people. They're not the same thing. But I think you should just find the right informational way to strike so that you don't actually have to harm anyone and you can bring human rights abuses to light and actually use the processes that do work. And I think if you have that action, or if you have the ability, if you have a clean record, right? If you don't, like, obviously have an association with all of us here, for example, you can make a lot of difference. It only takes one person in this audience to infiltrate one of these organizations to find a list of all the murderers. So one of you should just go out and do it. Fuck them up. You'll actually stop it. And nothing we say up here is going to change that. But you can change that. I can't do that. She can't do that. I don't know if you can do that.
We can publish it, though.
But we'll publish it, of course. WikiLeaks will definitely publish it.
That's actually a point that's worth making. There's quite a lot of, you know, what's ethical journalism, blah, 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 blah. These people are criminals. Publish the names so they can be gotten. If you get at people that publish names, we're going to they are criminals. They are doing wrong, and their names should be published so they can be caught. And I feel very strongly that criminals should... we shouldn't shy away from publishing the names of criminals when they're in documents.
Thank you very much. I brought the topic of drone wars because I think it's the most prominent, the most spectacular, the most awful outcome of the global surveillance state. But what are the... And I think it should be some point which could be scandalized, but let's look on global surveillance. The other... just the daily life devices. If you look at what they can do with any smartphone, and this is part of the revelations you, for instance, were working on, what's left for us with our daily electronic life? What can every person do to be independent from the surveillance?
I mean, it totally depends, but for the most part, if you're being targeted by an intelligence agency, I mean, you're just fucked. I mean, there's like no effective remedy for a well-funded adversary that, you know, I mean, look, it doesn't even have to do with technology. It just has to do with security economics. And at the core, if you're part of Antifa, for example, and you're organizing in some way to protect, let's say, some immigrant's house against a fascist organization, the fascist organization has more people and they're able to get to that house and light it on fire, and you can't stop them, it's going to burn, right? You have to have an effective strategy. And when you use technology that's in the framework of a framework of domination, using end-to-end crypto might help you a little bit, but as soon as you're targeted, they have specific steps they take in order to subvert your devices or to subvert devices that are near you, right? That's the thing that's very scary. And so you really have to scope the adversary that you're worried about. So if you're worried about the NSA and the NSA is really targeting you, you should go analog. You should build a data trail that tells a totally different story about you than the story that you're using in your daily life. You need to be very careful about that. You know, you have to really take a lot of steps, like crazy steps. Like my computers, I remove all the microphones, I reflash chips with custom software, I do ridiculous stuff to my computers. And even then, it only just buys me a little bit of time. And for other activities, what I usually do is I don't use computers at all. Or I use computers that are one-time throwaway computers. This is not practical. And this is because fundamentally, these adversaries simply just have more power than we can deal with. There's just no effective technological remedy to this kind of a social problem. And the fact that you have secret services in Germany that actually basically work for the United States should tell you how ineffective some of these remedies are. So I think it's very difficult to give you hope about it. Like if you have a cell phone, it's contributing to a data set for surveillance and you just can't win. I mean, I have a few different phones that I use for different things. And for sure, those data points go into my permanent record, as they say. Unfortunately, you can't win with that because these networks are designed to spy on you. They're designed to create data about you. And even the billing system. So in capitalism, the billing system has in fact created some of the most effective surveillance measures. You know, so every minute you want to call someone, it's tracked. In some cases, there's data retention where it's required to know who was called, how long the call lasted. And of course, the systems themselves are designed to be spied on. So if someone were to compromise, let's say the German so-called lawful intercept system or the Russian one or the American one, and they'd be able to listen to the content of your calls. And these systems are just designed badly. So if you really care about your privacy, you just have to know that you've lost. Because all the systems are designed against you. Every single one. There's not a single system that you can use off the shelf that isn't a free software hippie solution that's going to help. I mean, I help build hippie free software solutions, so I say that with some love. But if you go to like MediaMart and buy something, if you look at what any politician is using, it's all horrible. It's terrible. And it's just awful, awful, awful. Bad crypto, or there's no crypto, or it phones home to a corporation, or whatever. And the mass surveillance systems are set up to just ingest that data and stick it directly into corporate, so-called corporate repositories. So I'm sorry to be so depressing about it. I could also say something like install Redphone, Signal, and TechSecure, and like, you know, there's an app for that or something. But there's no app for you fucking failed to keep your democracy, America, Germany, et cetera. Right? So, sorry.
So, thanks. What has to be said has to be said. So, Sarah, last question.
I said sorry to be such a box of razors.
Oh, sometimes has to be. So, Sarah, you're the journalist who saved Edward Snowden, basically. And what is your advice for anyone who wants to step forward and blow the whistle?
One, can you come to me before your picture is on the front page of every newspaper in the world? It would really help. Yeah, but I mean, it would be easier and, you know, like, please. Maybe we would only have to spend a day in an airport, not a month. I think one of the things for potential whistleblowers is to understand that there's your technical security, your operational security, and then also that with whom you work with. So first off, shut up. Don't talk to anybody. Go to people experts in this. And they are people that need to be experts in the technical and operational side. And there's very few of those. I've seen quite a few talks of actually very good journalists and just making horrendous statements on the tech side. So I think you need to go to somebody that understands both, including the legal consequences as well. There are things you can do to set up certain things so that if the worst does happen, you have certain ability for certain defenses in court that you can otherwise get out the way if you haven't set those up beforehand. But it very much is a situational concept. Situation-specific question. Right? I mean, how does somebody get the data out of an office securely will depend on the setup of the office, and it's a completely different answer if you work for a bank or a government institution or an intelligence institution or whatever. So, but I think thinking about it early and speaking to people that really are experts in it, which is very few in the world, right from the very, very beginning, from the point that you're going to take the data before that.
And who do they contact?
Me. we've set up an organization specifically for this. It's running the defense funds of and we have an emergency case as well at the moment, four whistleblowers and journalistic sources at the world. We have a few more that we announced in the next few weeks, and we have technical and operational security experts as well as journalists too, and we've been doing this for many, many years between us. So it's called the Courage Foundation.
I think, you know, one thing to add is, I mean, Sarah really did, I think, an amazing thing by helping Snowden. And I think that she helped him to exercise his right to seek and to receive asylum. And it's really an amazing thing that someone has done this. And a big thing that is very scary about this is that you can't really blow the whistle these days without blowing up your own life on really serious issues with very, very large political adversaries. And it's important to recognize, I think, that she is the person that made that happen. I mean, she and Julian Assange. She really hates it when I do that. Sorry. But she really did that, and I think she's a great role model for that. And I think the thing is that if you want to leak documents, the best thing to do is, if you can do it anonymously, to submit them to WikiLeaks anonymously. Don't try to do everything. Try to do a little part that's sustainable. Because one thing that's very clear to me is that we don't have a movement right now that can really sustain 1,000 Edward Snowdens. And it's not clear to me that, for example, we could bring 1,000 Edward Snowdens to Germany. We can't even bring one Edward Snowden to Germany to seek and to receive asylum. So there are lots of different things. And the Courage Foundation is the most extremely awesome group working on really helping sources. But a good thing to do if you have some documents to leak is to try to do it anonymously, to not become one of the benefactors of Courage if you can, and or to support Courage's work.
They can become a benefactor, not a beneficiary. We need the money. Benefactors, please do come here.
I'm so glad. Trolling is art. Yeah, so I think it's very important to support the work that's being done, but if you have documents, maybe don't become someone that Courage protects if you can help it. That's a really useful thing to do. So really take a lot of steps. I think possibly no one in the audience here is one of these people, but if you are one of those people, definitely try to protect yourself long beforehand. Really think about it and really make a plan about that. I mean, one thing that's clear to me about Snowden is he really thought about this for a very long time. And his life really, in some ways, is totally destroyed. I think he has a very fulfilling, good life now, but I also think that it's completely different than the life that he had. And I think that probably that's not always the choice that people want to make. And it's a very respectable choice, but there are many other choices. It's not just a choice between something and absolutely everything. And there's little steps in between. And I think, for example, the best thing that people can do is to form a really tight conspiracy, your best friends, and work on whatever you guys can sustain. Conspiracy has a positive connotation in German, I'm told, so I mean it in the positive sense. But really to work together in tight groups and to work on whatever you can sustain. That's, I think, really what needs to be done, really working on it. So, for example, I think most of the political parties in Germany really fail when it comes to protecting themselves from surveillance. So if you're involved with a local political group, try to treat pervasive monitoring and surveillance as a vulnerability. Try to think about how to secure ourselves against it. Because for sure, anyone involved in any radical work or doing anything that's even remotely possible to be twisted around into something that could be considered illegal, for example, helping someone seeking and receiving asylum, for example, could be very sensitive. You really have to work very hard on that from a technical perspective and from a social perspective. And a lot of the Antifa people I've met in Berlin in particular, who I really respect the work that they're doing, they've got the social stuff down really well. They know exactly who to work with. They know exactly how to take care, how to move people, how to keep them safe, how to feed them, to receive medical care. But when it comes to surveillance, they're not always doing really well. The best ones are the ones that just give up on technology entirely, know they can't do well at it, and so they just cut it out. That doesn't always work, though, because you don't always get a choice if you interact with surveillance systems or with electronic systems. But really trying to work with communities that you know about and care about these issues is probably one of the best places to make an impact.
So thanks a lot. I think it's a good point to have a question and answer with you, the audience. But one sentence, you already mentioned it. I forgot to mention Martina Renner should be here with us. He's very ill today. High fever, because she's for the left in the Parliamentary Inquiry Commission on NSA and BND, and they're working the whole week and 12, 13 hours questioning the guys who won't answer. It's like what you described. You ask the suspect to deliver the proof, and you got stuck. So. Good wishes to her, and she say we'll continue the struggle, and she would love to be here. And now we have questions, answers. Fabian from Helle Panke is the host, and he will deliver the microphone. Maybe you can step forward because it has it's not Wi-Fi, it's on the cable, so you need to come to him. If you want to have short questions, short comments, and these both would love to answer and talk with you. Please.
Bevor ihr Fragen stellt, die Rosa-Luxemburg-Stiftung ist natürlich auch an Daten interessiert. wir brauchen noch Unterschriften, damit wir sozusagen das, unser Geld vom Staat kriegen. Aber ihr könnt natürlich auch eure E-Mail-Adresse angeben, dann werdet ihr weiterhin informiert, was es noch für Veranstaltungen in diesem Rahmen gibt.
Das ist wirklich lustig. Unglaublich. Unglaublich.
So, wer will denn was fragen?
Genau. Wer eine Frage hat, erhebt sich bitte und nähert sich dem jungen Mann an. Vielleicht ich.
Ja. Thank you very much for talking this evening. It was awesome. And my question is, sorry. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you for talking this evening. And my question was, like, how effective is the global mass surveillance state against for their actual goal, the goal to like fight terrorism, and how effective is it, or and how much is it used to discredit journalists or whatever opposing political party, which, as far as I got, is actually happening, like they're collecting, incriminating information on some politicians and everything. So yeah, are there any like internal reports you have access to from the Snowden documents that actually prove the or disprove the effectiveness of this whole thing?
So thank you for your question. I just asked Sarah if I could answer it. I really want to just say one thing, which is, if you wonder how effective surveillance is, look at the wars that my country has been waging. When people think about, well, we'll use surveillance to stop terrorism, they're forgetting that the surveillance systems are used to enable capitalist imperialist wars. Right? It's extremely effective at waging terroristic wars. That's actually one of the goals of the surveillance systems, to be better war fighters. And it is extremely effective at that. It is also effective at capturing and monitoring really stupid terrorists who don't have any technical knowledge at all. That doesn't mean someone without technical knowledge is really stupid, but I mean to say, going to, say, Al-Qaeda's homepage and trying to download a manual without using any encryption at all, without doing anything, is definitely not high on the intelligence scale. It definitely finds people. It's very useful for that. But the primary purpose of it is imperialist domination. It's extremely effective for assisting capitalist wars. That is absolutely the case, and it is terrifyingly so. And for example, in the Iraq War, it is the case that General Alexander talks about the response times going from 19 hours to 9 minutes, thanks to NSA surveillance. So somewhere between 100,000 and 1 million people were killed with the NSA's assistance in that war. I would say that surveillance is extremely effective at wiping out Muslims, which was one of the goals of using the surveillance during the Iraq War. You know, that's fucked, by the way. But that's absolutely effective, and that's what it's useful for. And the fact that they can also get some Al-Qaeda people and some ISIS people sometimes is how they get a lot of credit, and they look like the good guys, but they also use it to know that they are going to do a bombing in an area where there are civilians, and they use that to calculate basically whether or not they should do the attack. Well, just a few children, sure, right? And that is absolutely the case. You see that with a lot of governments when they use surveillance, and that is effective. So just remember, it's not a choice between terrorism and no terrorism with the surveillance. It's a choice of killing lots of people and using surveillance to do it, or killing a lot of people and not using as much surveillance to do it. Really a bad situation, actually, and that's a very effective thing.
I agree with everything Jake was saying, and then if you take a recent example of the Charlie Hebdo attacks, these were actually persons identified, people that were identified as persons of interest and should have been being surveilled in a targeted way according to the systems of the intelligence agencies, but they'd completely broken down, they weren't doing it, and the attack happened. So it's very good for the things that they don't admit that it's for, but it's actually used for consciously, and the things that they sort of pretend that it's used for because it's a good PR and propaganda spin for the general public, it's completely failing at. So I really hate it when the term national security is bandied around at all, and it's particularly used a lot in this surveillance debate. And if you look at, for example, it came out after the raid with Bin Laden that there was no electronic communications going on. I mean, a TV show was able to get years before the Snowden revelations the fact that drug dealers weren't running around with phones that were tied to themselves. So people have understood these sorts of things and have been working separately from it anyway, from these technical things. So to when they put out this, oh well, the Snowden revelations have hurt our national security, it is in every single way completely and utterly rubbish. What it's starting to stop is their ability to get an economic and political advantage through mass surveillance. That is all that it's helping.
One thing that I would add is in the case of the Hebdo attacks, you know, there's a natural kind of operational security in working in like a family-like unit. I mean, it just comes from the fact that if you like live somewhere and you know someone and you talk to them on a daily basis, it's very difficult for someone to surveil. When you have a free society where people can freely talk, they can freely conspire in a way where you won't be able to spy on them. And that's, in some ways, that's actually good. I think, in fact, it's in almost all ways it's really good. Obviously, there are some people that will abuse that. I think that that's the cost you pay to live in a free society. I would also say that the root cause is very rarely ever examined, which the people that were involved in the Hebdo attack, these are people that are radicalized by things like Guantanamo Bay, where we got rid of the Geneva Conventions and we started kidnapping and torturing and killing people. So if we look to the root cause, we might find that we, in fact, have to look at ourselves. At least as an American, it's very clear to me that when we say the Geneva Convention doesn't apply, we're creating people who exist outside of that framework, and that is a terrifying thing. It's very terrifying. And that's, in fact, very off topic from your question, but a good side point, I think, to make.
Interesting nonetheless, Jake. Interesting nonetheless.
I mean, it really is the case that if you want to stop that kind of terrorism, you have to create a more egalitarian, fair world for every person. When people don't have a right to eat, don't have a right for a place to sleep, they don't have a right to an education, and they have to fight each other and compete in a so-called free market capitalist society.
And then you
society.
Fly in and drone them whilst they're trying to send their kid to school, and then they're a bit upset about it? I mean, really.
Yeah, exactly. People have a right to resist. If I lived in Yemen, I'd be downing fucking drones every day. That's absolutely a moral right of people. And, I mean, obviously, I should never go to Yemen, now that I've said that in public, but you can resist these surveillance systems, but obviously, it's very different to resist the surveillance systems than all the systems that they're helping, actually.
So, thank you. Next question, please.
Sarah, you mentioned at the beginning that less than 1% of the treasures of Snowden are published. Could you?
Well, of what Glenn has said he has, he's published less than 1%. It's a Glenn statement, but yeah.
So my question is a different one. Maybe Selectus List is amongst the treasures. Could you think of ways to publish at least the Selectus List as far as it would be upsetting the economy? Because they are worried about it, and it's, of course, a better political field to pursue against the selectors list, some people are from the economy side. Thank you.
There's definitely selectors and there's definitely commercial espionage that goes on. Are you asking what my publication strategy for such a thing would be? Who knows what's in our pipeline? Who knows?
So next question, please.
Hello. I wanted to spread some hope because it's been a bit dark here.
Are we a bit too depressing for everybody?
And I have hackers like us, or like especially Jake, he's been working so long on technologies like this, and we're always making like just one step of progress, and then the NSA is throwing us three steps back, and we feel like the internet is actually getting worse. But there's a perspective that hackers usually do not see, and it's a perspective that politicians know and that people should feel empowered of. If there is a political will, if there's a movement of people, if there's the power to change politics, politics can influence technology, politics can change technology. We can build telephones that cannot be easily surveilled if we really want it. We can build a telephone system that does not track where we are going to because we could be anonymously using the telephone system. We can have a telephone system that is paid by anonymous payment and so it doesn't matter who is anywhere. These things are technically possible. Even the internet itself, we could make a new internet which does encryption on the lowest levels and destroys all the platform that these governments are using to see what we're doing. And we could destroy the foundation of all this surveillance. But there's no commercial interest in doing this. There's no business model for this. So we can't expect any company to come up and fix our democracy. It has to be us. We have to get in charge in politics to change this. And maybe we should go to the streets about it.
Thank you.
Also, yeah, okay. I just have one question to Jake. Jake.
I love you.
Why didn't you take me to Berkan yesterday night?
I'm not interested in men with beards. Sorry. Shave, honey. Just to be clear about it, I think that what he says is correct. We do have, I mean, for example, it is the case that mathematics fundamentally can be used to protect us. But one of the things that we see happening is that standardization organizations, for example, in the United States, like NIST, they're supposed to tell you what the truth is. They're supposed to tell you, this is a secure thing, this is not a secure thing, use this, use that. But we learn through Snowden about a project called Project Bull Run. And that's where they subvert all of the encryption standards or try to subvert them wherever they can. So part of the problem is that our society is built on being able to trust our institutions. And those very institutions have been co-opted and corrupted. And so it's very difficult to know, in fact, if we redesign the internet, if the fundamental building blocks we would like to use, if we can really trust them. And this is a really big problem. But he's right that we can do this. I think we need an entire generation of people to die off so that people who know how to use technology can have a political will. And unfortunately, in that process, we'll lose a lot of the old left-wing intellectuals, which means that all government will swing really far to the right. And it's very terrifying. But when Strobola dies, I'm sorry to say, someday he will, but if it's a great loss to the intellectual capacity of the German political world. And it is the case that this renewal is unfortunately what seems to be coinciding with people understanding technology. And I don't really have a good solution for that other than to say that we have to radicalize the youth that understand how to use computers and get them involved in politics. But that is still not enough because many of the people, like in Merkel's cabinet, they do understand technology. They get it completely and it's in their benefit how they understand it. They understand how the surveillance systems work. They benefit from it. So, you know, maybe you should go work for her. Be the next Snowden. Shave.
Okay, I would like to know what are your thoughts on the relationship between corporations and the state surveillance? Because there was wide knowledge that US corporations were, of course, they had to cooperate and hand over all their data to the NSA, and then there was a public conflict that they didn't want it, and at the same time there is a huge amount of data collected by them for business interests. So what are your thoughts on how this relates?
I think that a line, I mean, there are rules and regulations over what data should be kept, some of them for actually logistical necessity in a very few number of cases. But what we already, as it stands, we have to be very clear about the difference between what a company has to give, even within the current constraints, what it should have to give, and what the extent to which they are actually cooperating. And I think that there is a large difference, and a lot of companies are voluntarily giving more. There's also a difference in how they'll react to things like subpoenas, whether they'll fight it or not. I mean, Levinson, who had the unfortunate situation of running Snowden's email account, ended up actually shutting his company down to avoid having to give up all of Snowden's emails. So, I mean, that's just one extreme of how companies could be cooperating. On the other, we have companies like Google that have been allowing the NSA to do certain things. It's a really big question. I mean, Julian's written literally two books on it, one of them with Jake. So maybe I should just say go and read Julian's books because it's a big question.
Yeah, we wrote a book called Cypherpunks, and you should BitTorrent it. Don't buy it. It's not good enough to pay money for, but it's reasonable enough to pirate. The other one is When Google Met WikiLeaks. That's maybe worth buying. I think it's pretty good. I would also pirate that too. I think that you should just download them. It's fine. I don't think anybody will mind. Maybe except the publisher, but whatever. You know, Julian and I think would like you to read it more than we would like you to not read it. The reality of the situation with corporations, though, is very clear to me. When the NSA talks about their data collection, they call themselves the corporation. When they put data into a database, they call it a corporate repository. One of the things we see in a capitalist society, especially in an advanced capitalist society like the United States, is that corporations become kind of a wing of the state. Under Section 215 of the Patriot Act and under many other rules, one of the things that we see is that corporations are, in fact, essentially privatized arms where you have deputized individuals inside of the corporation that hand over interesting data. And there's basically no separation. I've heard, for example, I can't confirm it, so I say this as like a speculative thing, that there exists computer security companies who, when they're hired to perform a security audit of a company, let's say Microsoft as an example, like I said, it's a speculative rumor, I'm not entirely sure if this is true, I haven't been able to confirm it, that they did the audit, they produced the result, which included finding vulnerabilities, and they were forced to hand over their work product under the business records provision of the Patriot Act several years ago. And they were given a piece of paper that ordered them to do it, and on the back it said, this is the whistleblowing procedure if you feel your rights have been violated. They were still able to give this information to their client, but they were not allowed to tell their client that the report had also been given to this three-letter agency. Now, what that says to me is that there's a marriage of corporations and the state. And in some cases, the corporations, they don't go along willingly. But in a lot of cases, they do go along willingly. That's what Julian's book actually is all about. So, I mean, generally when you have states and corporations merging like that, you have a kind of fascism, and it's really scary stuff. And so we have to look to build peer-to-peer alternatives. And if we don't, we're going to be reliant on third parties like Google or Microsoft or Apple, where they're going to be forced. And there, some cases they're just going to go willingly. And that's a huge threat. And when entire countries and entire cities outsource all their email, like for example, I think in the Netherlands, a lot of universities are having all their university emails going to Google Apps, for example. That seems like a really bad idea. Because as soon as anyone does anything interesting there, they're subject to surveillance law in the United States. And the Netherlands, for example, is generally not US citizens, so they're not even people, really, under our laws. Really, they're not US persons, right? And so they don't have rights in the same way that you would expect to have rights, even though, in theory, America is a safe harbor. It's not. It shouldn't be considered a safe harbor. They don't respect European notions of data privacy. So it's a really big topic. To echo what Sarah said, I would read Julian's two books about this, and I would definitely try to build, as the Italian gentleman said, you know, these free software hippie solutions. And I think that's the right thing to do. And for example, Die Linke, I especially expect the left to be involved in building a lot of free software, funding free software, like the free software hippie with the beard that was talking, the really nice guy. He is a person who, if he could be paid by a political party to work full-time thinking about these things, he's like exactly the person that should be doing it. But I'm guessing...
He's got a beard, though.
He does have a beard. But he... Sorry, but it's true. I mean, we need to find people like him and to make it sustainable for them to build solutions that respect human rights and respect due process. And if we don't do that, we're not going to win. Corporations or the state. There's almost no difference.
There's an interesting trend that we're in. This is clearly a U.S. tactic. And if you look at the large international trade agreements that are being negotiated at the moment, TTIP being one, TPP being the other, TISA being the other, least known, but actually one of the most extensive ones. And the strategy we can see in the documents of those that the leaked ones that have been published by us is actually this opening up states to allow corporations in, but with such great rights, and let's not kid ourselves, these are all US corporations that the US is sitting on these other poorer countries, forcing them to sign these agreements that will allow US corporations in, open up the market for US corporations only. They will end up losing their sovereignty in a number of things. They, you know, things like national post services are now, for these countries, are now under threat because we're going to allow the US postal companies in. And this is definitively a tactic that the US is using to take over the whole world through its corporate frontier, essentially taking over all emerging markets.
Okay. Hi. As someone who's been interested in this sort of thing since WikiLeaks was just a concept, I'd just like to start by saying thank you for this. It's good to finally be in a time and a place where at least some people care about the future of democracy.
See Berlin? Yep. Finally, you can care. You see, you are better than everyone else.
My question for you is, well, as important as the drones are, I try and think long term, and I think we're already in a post-democracy kind of society, but I can see it getting a lot worse. I'm wondering if you have any anecdotes, or is there any evidence yet for lawmakers, judges being actively blackmailed? Because I think that's where we're going if we're not already. Am I being naive?
Do you mean? Like when we found that Chancellor Merkel was spied on by the NSA, and then the rest of the process that followed, like how Harold Range not prosecuting because they didn't get the evidence. I mean, like, what the fuck are you talking about? I don't understand it, because we revealed that the Chancellor of Germany was being spied on by the NSA. Then Germany knew that that was happening, and in the years that have followed, there's been no effective remedy about that. No mass surveillance has stopped. There was no spy agreement. I mean, do you want the NSA to like specifically show that there's like been some sexting and they were going to threaten to reveal it? Is that what you mean?
Yeah, imagine a whole panel of judges where somebody was actually like an important decision was circumvented, and we know that for a fact, instead of just a passive surveillance threat.
Oh. There's so many things to say to what you just said. I don't have specific evidence of a judge in Germany, for example, being spied on. But I think it's very clear that there's an implicit threat, and probably an explicit threat, that when you know your chancellor has been spied on, they know who they really work for. Right? I mean, it's very clear that surveillance, you know you're guilty of something. And you know that someone else can tell that story in a much more incriminating, horrible way. So I think that, gray mail would be the phrase. I think that that's very clear. We have seen evidence of that. We have seen evidence of economic espionage. We have seen evidence, which ironically the German government won't reveal more details about the selectors where the European Parliament and other people are being spied upon. We haven't lately seen something so direct, but we do see the NSA, for example, looking for so-called extremist Muslims, looking at pornography so that they can use that to harm specific people and to discredit them. We do see that the British government has a group called JTRIG, where the purpose is to do psychological disruption. I mean, we see a lot of those things, and we see the structures in place for having human operatives inside of groups. For example, there's a guy named Mark Kennedy in the United Kingdom, and his job was literally to be a state rapist. So he would infiltrate environmental activist groups and then sleep with women in those groups as a police officer for the state in order to infiltrate them. He's a free person. I know the person who dated him for many years, and it's a really sad story. We see those things all the time. I kind of hope we don't get to the world where we see a very specific judge and a very specific case, but I'm sure that it exists. There have been a number of people, including other NSA whistleblowers, who have specifically said they've seen transcripts of Supreme Court judges and of Barack Obama before he was president. I think that was Tice that revealed that. Nathaniel Tice, I think is his name. I forget. Anyway, the point is he specifically said that he'd seen exactly that from the NSA. So, I mean, you can decide with all the things that are public if we really need to go much further to know that that's happening. It's very clear that it's happening, and it's also very clear that it has subverted a lot of the normal processes in Germany directly. I mean, I know that I behave completely differently, knowing that there's probably sex tapes being made in my, not just by me, you know? So, not to imply what I think I just implied, but you get the point.
Wenn es Fragen gibt, bitte sich erheben und dort anstellen beim Mikrofon. Fabian mit dem blauen T-Shirt nimmt sie entgegen. Die nächste Frage, bitte.
So, as far as I remember, there was a plan by Glenn Greenwald to publish the whole documents he got from Edward Snowden. So my first question is there still such a plan to give all the information into public hand? To yeah. And the second, do you think would this be a good step, a helpful step for the whole debate?
Can I go first? Yeah. I would love it if Glenn had said he was going to publish everything. One of the saddest things to me is Glenn has come out several times and said that he won't, definitively that he won't. He has said that he is going to open it up more and publish a lot more, hopefully with more media partners. So I'm really looking forward to when that happens, and maybe we can step up. None of us will be alive. Certainly those 68ers won't be alive if we keep going at this rate. So hopefully that happens, but it's probably more a question for Glenn Greenwald. What would happen? I think one of the most important things of full publication is that the specific details that often are redacted are actually published. We've seen actually in a number of cases through their publication that it is those details that people would try to redact that A, are the technical details that can help people think of a solution, or they actually create, because people understand that they as a demographic are targeted, they're actually able to make movements against it. A whole country, for example, that was tried to be redacted. Afghanistan were then able to find out and that they were under surveillance, and actually all the president did was try and close those NSA bases down. So it did hurt the United States' political interests in those countries, but it didn't hurt anything else. So I think that we would just see more of that, and our experience in our publishing history has just shown that full publication just brings not only better, but more longer-term results that are more fixed. Anybody now can go and see if there were, for example, US diplomats messing in their legal case that was going on because of the concept of full publication. So I hope what you said at the beginning is will happen, but sadly they've said the opposite so far.
Yeah, I do think that it would be wonderful if the situation was, so let me back up and say, I've worked a lot with Laura Poitras and with Der Spiegel here in Germany, and worked with a number of publications elsewhere in the world to publish things. It's very clear to me that one of the reasons we don't see more documents released is because journalists believe that they're right on the edge of what is permissible. And there's a lot of fear. And one of the first things about being afraid is that you say you don't have anything to hide or you don't have any fear. And so what needs to be done to make it so that Sarah's dream can come true, and you should work to make Sarah's dreams come true, personally, work as hard as you can. We need to actually create the grounds under which, if the full documents were to be released, the journalists wouldn't be feeling like they're going to be hung. That's what has to happen. That is, in fact, a political outcome that we have to work very hard to create. And that is one of the things that you see. The other thing that needs to be done is it needs to be the case that those journalists who are not necessarily as brave as Julian Assange and Sarah Harrison, that they too can participate in this. And that is something which is very difficult indeed, because right now, I would say Glenn and Laura and other people working on it, in some ways, there's a victory lap going on. And in some ways, it's true. You know, they can travel back to the United States. They're free. Things are good. But in a sense, that changes the dynamic of the work. And it means that they're less likely to take new risks now because they took the big risk and they made the big change. And in some ways, that's why I think it's important that we need more sources, precisely because right now there's almost a monopoly on the number of people that have these documents. I work with these documents, and I am contractually bound basically not to publish certain things, and I'm honor-bound with Laura and Glenn to not publish specific things. And it's fucking heartbreaking to me that that's the condition, and I'm not going to betray my trust to them. So I hope that someone can make that irrelevant by getting the same documents a different way and publishing them fully. But that requires a lot of groundwork. And if we want to change it for these other journalists, we have to change the fundamental groundwork. Like, if Germany passed a law that said, if you publish these things, nothing will happen to you, or, hey, how about just a whistleblower protection law in Germany? That would, for example, make a world of difference. But since we're right on the edge of permissibility, you're going to see a lot of things that are nice that will not happen as a result of the fear. And the fear is strong, and it is powerful. And unfortunately, that is where we are now. But there's a lot of stuff that has yet to be published that's absolutely fucking unbelievable. Crazy stuff. And I'm sorry that that's all I can say about it. That's horrible, but it's true. Yeah, I mean, don't ever use a telephone. That's the other thing I would tell you. Like, you cannot, never in Russia, and not just because of the Russians, never in Germany, like, just do not use telephones. Telephones are like the absolute worst thing you can imagine from a privacy perspective. Every time you use a telephone, there's, for example, in certain countries, there's voice mapping, so they know exactly who you are as well as where you are. I mean, it's just the technological advantage that intelligence agencies have is just unbelievable. And for almost every field, it's very similar. It's just not evenly spread out through the whole world yet. Anyway, sorry.
Just to finish off, one thing to be clear, I mean, Glenn and Laura, in the work that they've done, have done amazing work on these documents. And I think that it can only be obvious in their mind, having worked very closely with Julian in journalistic work, it can only, I imagine, be completely obvious to them that if they go one single step further, they are running a very large risk of ending up, like Julian is, in one room with two surveillance vans outside his house, his room. 10 police circling him the whole time, an entire FBI investigation going on against him in the US, trying to get him for espionage, conspiracy to commit espionage, Computer Fraud and Abuse Act, to have his name by politicians all over the US and a number of other countries saying that he should be shot and droned, to have an entire PR spin machine to try and take him down on a personal basis. So when you've watched this happen to someone you've worked closely with and you are working on the Snowden documents and you've done some good work and you've done, you know, this debate has started and that's your lesson, how many people would go and publish as bravely as Julian Assange has? Not many.
So, Jack, you were talking about what we all can do, and you were suggesting to the audience that we go to inside the organizations and blow the whistle. And I believe this is a great thing. But at the same time, I believe that we as a movement against surveillance need also different strategies. So I just want to point out some other things you can do against surveillance. First of all, you can talk to your friends, or like to say, talk to your friends and family. That is a very important issue for all for human society. The next thing is contact politicians that you are opposed to surveillance, and especially here in Germany, contact politicians of the SPD that you are opposed to the Vorratsdatenspeicherung. And another thing is you can go to a crypto party and bring some friends with you. There are many crypto parties every week in Berlin. So this is a great thing also to get in contact with people who are deep in the subject. And last but not least, I like to say I believe that we also need protest on the streets. And therefore, I like to invite you all. There is an ongoing protest action every Saturday here in Berlin at the new building of the BND, of the Bundesnachrichtendienst, against mass surveillance, against the BND, and against the drone killings. So it's every Saturday at 4 o'clock p.m. Join the protest so we can make a change. Thanks.
I think the protest that you're holding is really great, and I really hope that everyone will actually join. I was not suggesting protest. I was suggesting resistance, right? To go back to Ulrike Meinhof, right? Protest is not what we need now. We need active resistance. So joining a crypto party is part of active resistance. But that's what we need, is active resistance. Protesting is also good, for sure, but we need to take it a step further. If it was actually a sit-in that actually blocks people from building the building, and it was every day, all day, as an encampment, forcing it to change it, that will also make it, that actually makes a real difference in a very, very specific way. It stops the surveillance system that's being built and the, you know, the actual building itself from being finished. And so, yeah, it requires organization. And I think it's really important that you're doing that. And I think there are many tactics and many strategies to be taken. And I want to honor the fact that you are organizing this. I think it's really great. So maybe we could all give him a round of applause.
Hi. Michele, it's my birthday today, that's why I'm allowed to make 3 statements. Thank you, Short.
It's a classic German leftist tradition that first you start off your question with a 5-minute speech, and then you answer your own question, and then you ask the question again rhetorically. So you can do that 3 times, and we're going to be fine with that.
First, I'm rather skeptical about maybe the fight against mass surveillance, and wonder whether we may not already have lost it for 2 reasons. Because the revelations of Edward Snowden have not taken off and caused this huge public outcry, which they would have really deserved. Secondly, because maybe it's a curiosity is in human nature, in all our human nature. And thirdly, maybe this drive for power and control is within, inbuilt in society as well. And therefore, that this old this dogma of everything that is technically possible will be done must just be taken as it is and for granted, and we have to face it somehow. So, what is maybe the solution on that, or what is the way forward? And I say that.
Sorry,
that
you're just literally doing what Jake said.
That it's whistleblowing. That it's whistleblowing that has to become much more prominent, much more accepted, and much more welcome in society and within the legal system. And therefore, I say whistleblowing must be established as a fundamental human right, which triggers, therefore, also the right of asylum.
Okay, thank you.
No, that was one.
So
because he answered it himself, we can still have a go, no?
Yes, okay.
We're 100% on board with you. Yeah. There's no question. We completely agree with everything that you said, except for almost all of everything up until the very last point, which is to say, we didn't lose because there is no winning, buddy. That's the point. This is an eternal struggle that exists throughout all of human history. It's not against mass surveillance. It's for social justice and human rights. Mass surveillance is one of the problems, but drone murder, that's connected to mass surveillance. But the issue is not about the fact that they were surveilled, it's the fact that they were murdered, the fact that they were killed without due process, the fact that the reason they can be killed is because they're Muslims in a faraway over there Istan land. So I'm not in an anti-surveillance world, that's not my movement. My movement is to smash the fucking state when it does not care about human rights and social justice for every person without any exceptions. Every person. Without any exceptions, for a world where people don't have to fight each other for very basic necessities, for food, for clothing, for education. So we haven't lost, because right now, at the same time there's someone getting a liver transplant, that there's someone probably having a very seriously hard day, or starving, or dying, or being drone struck. We have both the winning and the losing happening simultaneously, always, all the time. So don't think about it in terms of winning and losing like we've lost to mass surveillance. We live in a world where revolutionary change occurred, and the revolutionaries aren't Snowden, me, Sarah, or Julian. It's General Alexander and George W. Bush. It's Merkel. She's the revolutionary. She took you from a constitutional republic with due process to one with mass surveillance. Right? And we're the counter-revolutionaries. And what happens to us in the counter-revolutionary is we get shot, usually. But we haven't yet gotten shot, so we haven't yet lost, in my opinion. And I don't think that that's going to happen anytime soon, hopefully. But Germany has a great history of shooting people, so you never know. But don't be such a fatalist about it, I guess is what I'm trying to say. And yes, we need to establish a legal right for whistleblowing. And that is a specific, legitimate change to happen in Germany right now. And it needs to happen. And there has been a history of it failing to happen for at least 50 years, from what I understand, from some surveillance historians. But ultimately, we have to think in a much bigger way. It's not just about being against surveillance. It's what are we trying to build? We're trying to build a better world. And surveillance is one of the things that's actually preventing us from building a better world. It's, in fact, being used to enable a worse world on a daily basis. But we haven't lost. We have more clothes in our closet than we've ever had before. We have food on our table most nights. We are actually doing quite well. And we're able to freely talk about this in the open. That's really something to celebrate. I can't go back to the United States because it's not like that for me there anymore, right? So it can get a lot worse here, and it probably will if we have a fatalistic attitude about it, I think. Sorry to be so intense, but you know, two club mates are just fucking greatest roller coaster ride of your life.
Next question. No, I agree with the guy. I mean, like, Germany doesn't even have a direct translation for whistleblower. I mean, I think it's a long journey. I actually think that the whistleblower, I don't think there can ever be a national state whistleblower protection that will really work. I mean, when you get Snowden, it doesn't matter what the laws are. It needs to be an international collaboration. Again, that's like a massive, and it's a legal topic, so I'm not.
So, do we have time to for another one question? Yes, one question is left, and then we have the film, please.
Yeah, thank you. What I've been missing in the debate tonight, and also in the general public and debate in the media, is the role of the maybe general public, or simple people like me. And this is because the debate seems to be very much focused on surveillance, to which simple people out there can only feel powerless. And I think surveillance isn't this just the, it's this not only the, it's only the tip of the iceberg, I guess, of a much, much broader technological development of the way technological projects are sneaking into everyone's social lives. And the manipulation which can be caused by surveillance can be much more subtle than manipulating court decisions. Obama was elected by something that you could call also surveillance, but it's not called surveillance. It's just like big data and placing dynamic ads on Facebook, and I don't know. And isn't the so shouldn't we raise the question in this debate? How can we address everybody with regard to the surveillance that is happening in your pockets, with your mobile phones, in your homes, in the way you use technology? Isn't this something everybody should work on? And shouldn't, can we foster a debate raising public awareness, concerning effects of technology, rather than making it only the extreme question of surveillance and drone strikes.
So, you know, when Orson Welles, I think, interviewed Stalin, it was, Orson Welles said, "What about a regular guy like me?" And Stalin said something to him along the lines of, "You know, Orson Welles, you're not a regular guy. You're not a regular guy. You're a white man in Germany. Are you fucking kidding me? You're a regular guy? You're not. You're one of the most privileged people alive." Yeah, yeah, simple, whatever you want to say. You are one of the most privileged people ever alive. I am also in this, and it's important to talk about it. I agree, and I think I just said it in the last question. The issue here is about universal human rights, them being actually universal. It's not just about drone strikes. It's not just about mass surveillance. It's about social justice on a planetary scale where we have due process, and we have to exactly do what you're saying, which is changing it. I don't think anyone disagrees with that, and I think it is important, very clearly, that we do advance it in that direction. But it's also not entirely clear to me what it is that we're supposed to do when it is the case that we did establish the notion of universal human rights in the middle of the 20th century, and effectively we have undone that. We have thrown them away. We have gone away from the notion that we are equal, and instead we look at it and we say, well, it's a German, it's an American. Those people, they get spied on differently. They have different kinetic effects or so on. The drone issue, I think, makes it very clear for a number of people, but not how they're impacted by it. But it makes it clear where they stand on it, right? So if you tell someone about the drone killings and they don't do anything about it, and there is a clear thing to do, pick up the phone, call a representative, speak out against it, I think it becomes very clear that for everything else that follows from it, they knew about it and they didn't take action about it. That's not an effective strategy for change, but it is an effective strategy for understanding how people actually evaluate these things. And many people are very selfish about it, and they don't actually care about anything except themselves. And I don't know that we can do anything about those kinds of people. I think that that's unfortunate, but I just don't see it. And if you have a specific suggestion of what concrete action that each person could do here is, I'm definitely really down to hear about it, but I don't see a specific action, because we do live, I think, in some post-democratic times in some ways. And it isn't clear what I'm supposed to do as an immigrant in Germany, for example. I can't even vote here. Right? A lot of people are in a situation where they don't know what step is to be taken. And it's not because it's an abstract debate about drones. Right? So what specific step should we take? I think the clear thing is to have an actual equal discussion, not just a panel debate, where we try to come up with actual agency, where we try to have specific options which we can exercise. We should have a Congress about that. You know, the international socialist movement in the 20th century and the international workers of the world, they used to have Congresses where they would figure out these things and then work on them in an internationalist way. And we should have those things happening again, where relevant technical discussion as well as human rights discussion is actually happening, to put forth that not only to national but also to international bodies might be useful. Do you agree?
No.
Well, so tell us, what should we do?
Now you got my question wrong.
No.
Especially as I am a privileged person, I should do something, and this is...
But what is to be done?
Getting myself informed about technology in order not to buy an iPhone next time, for instance, and or maybe to see what alternatives there are for using Google and Facebook. This is what I should do, especially as I am a privileged person, because being privileged only means that you are unaware of these things, because the people are killed by drones elsewhere. And this is why we need something like digital empowerment or digital awareness raising or digitale Mündigkeit.
But we haven't built those things yet.
Yeah,
we have to figure out what those values are.
I was just asking about is how can we raise a debate, a public debate, about public self-empowerment of everyone's use of technology in the harmless sense, like Facebook and Google search.
Organize.
Yeah. Maybe we've completely missed your question, but I suppose it seems, without wanting to be too rude, my answer to be my answer to you would be, you actually seem to have a lot of ideas. Why are you asking us rather than doing them? And I don't mean that directly. I think that's the case of too many people, is that they just sit there and go, oh, well, I could do X, I could do Y, but you know, whatever. And then, of course, nothing happens. And I think an interesting thing to remember is that, for example, and we've seen it with some of the reactions to some companies in the Snowden revelations, is that companies will change their business practices if just 10% of their customer base requests it, and they won't lose the other 90% by making that change. So you actually don't need every single person to make a difference. The small margin will change a vote as well. So we don't need to get everybody involved, but we do need to start getting some people involved, and that takes instigators with ideas, as you seem to have. So maybe like you run the event you just described would be my first suggestion to you.
We take this as a closing point for the discussion and have the film Citizen 4, Oscar-winning documentary by Laura Poitras on Edward Snowden and everything around it. And I thank you so much for coming here, joining our talk. Just the beginning.